Hello everyone, welcome to the Captain's Video Blog. We are Wednesday, January 11th, 2017. So, it's almost 5 p.m. on Thursday, but it's not the same as last week. I really swear. The causes are pretty much the same, but it's actually pretty different. So, after recording yesterday's video blog, I just couldn't go to sleep just yet. Because everyone got up, and then my sister took one of the dogs to the vet, to a walk, I don't know. Just, it made the youngest dog just cry her heart out, and I just couldn't feel, you know, just couldn't sleep anymore, even if I tried. So, yeah, I decided to be a bit productive, actually. Did a little cleanup around the house with the vacuum cleaner, and because I was asked to do that, actually. And then I wrote the application letter for Lyon, which is something that's 3 weeks in the making. Yeah, so I finally made it. Oh, boy. Yeah, and then basically I just waited for her, for the young dog to calm down, and she did calm down around 2, 3 in the afternoon, and I went to sleep. And oversleeping would be really understating what happened to me. So I went to sleep, and then I slept for the end of the afternoon, and then the evening, and then the night. And I woke up in the early hours of the morning. But I say early, but it was a bit too late. Like, I had 10 minutes before everyone just woke up and got up. So I couldn't have watched all of wrestling, you know, Talking Smack, SmackDown, 205 Live, and did the video blog, because I mean, three hours and a half in 10 minutes is maybe a little bit impossible. So I waited for everyone to go out, watched wrestling, and then I had the three dogs who started barking. Like, what the fuck did they want this time? Those loud assholes. They wanted, all three wanted to go out, except it was impossible because the people for the chain link fence who were going to replace the chain link fence between my parents' garden and the neighbor's garden had actually removed it. So yeah, I couldn't let them out, because that would mean they would go to the neighbor's garden, and that's not possible. So yeah, just you know, I waited until they calmed down, and then they started again because they saw the people repairing the chain link fence, and I was like, ah, fuck you! And actually, they calmed down pretty fast. Well, I mean, not fast enough, because it is almost 5 p.m. So, yeah, on to SmackDown. I'll see if I have the time to talk about Paris versus Mess. Actually, I'm gonna talk about it. So Paris versus Mess, only 2-0 for Paris, which means one of three things. Either Mess are significantly better than Bastia, or Bastia are significantly worse than Mess. With, you know, it just doesn't mean the exact same thing. Or Paris just weren't in their show your power level mode to last night. And I'll be going for the third, because yeah, I don't see, you know, just didn't look like they were that much, you know, at the same level as last weekend. Then again, Mess's goalkeeper was pretty much on fire. So, yeah, moving on to SmackDown. So, SmackDown was fun. You know, some of the matches were pretty forgettable because it's the bigger story that that matters, but yeah, I mean, when the story matters, I guess that you can build a show about kind of weak matches. Then again, I wouldn't say weak. It would say pretty mediocre, like average. Mediocre, so in its etymological sense. Yeah, so SmackDown was in Baton Rouge, Louisiana, you know, Cajun country, near the bayou. That will come into play a bit later. So, yeah, Dean Ambrose opened the show with the Ambrose Asylum. Wanted to have a live alligator on show, but he didn't have the permit. The crowd booed for that, like, you fucking crazy. So he had actually a dead alligator's head on the show, called it Maurice, actually found it in a truck stop. So he entered himself in the Rumble, woohoo! Starting to introducing his guest, but the guest introduced, you know, interrupted his introduction. It was The Miz! Oh boy, is The Miz mad? He's not in straight jacket, but you can, you know, kind of picture it on him, because he's fucking mad! So, Miz entered himself in the Royal Rumble, you know, to defend the honor of the institution. I mean, he could be a favorite to win, but then again, it really looks like it's one of the old guys that entered themselves in the Royal Rumble on Raw, all through the past 3 months. That's our one of them is set to win. It just looks like that, or it's going to be you know mutually ensured destruction. I don't know. Or yeah. So the Mises wants to see Ambrose just being at the heart of legal issues all his life because he wanted to continue the match last week and not just have it thrown out. So there was a way out though. The way out was that he would hand the Miz the title. Ambrose didn't did that. Instead, he handed the Miz, you know, he presented the Miz with the Miz Participation Award, and the Miz flipped out, wailed on Ambrose, and he tried holding him up, holding Ambrose by the arms, so at the mercy of a slap by Maurice, and actually the slap missed the target because Ambrose, you know, lowered his head, and the slap went right into the Miz's face. So dirty deeds, and Dean Ambrose presented, you know, Maurice with the Miz Participation Award, which she accepted, and then she threw it out to attend her fallen husband. Yeah. Then Nikki Bella versus Natalya. Is it going to happen? Is it not going to happen? That was a question for about, 2 minutes, because it didn't happen. So there was this very, you know, this very cool thing. I love it when heels just assault their opponents when it's a heated, you know, it's a very heated rivalry, and they assault their opponent before even getting to the ring. Yes. Oh God, how many heels do you see doing that? The last time I recorded something like that happening is with the Nexus, and before that it's with Randy Orton attacking CM Punk, with CM Punk, you know, Randy Orton and the Legacy. It's always a couple of guys on one, and it's never one on one. There, Natalya threw Nikki Bella in an iron curtain, you know, with a just sneakered, and she was like, haha, see you in the ring, because the match was still scheduled. So Natalya was waiting in the ring, and Nikki Bella appeared, actually. So she went right at Natalya, took her down, a little bit of back and forth with the referees being, you know, basically useless. You know, they tried to separate the two of them, and they still jumped at each other. Natalya tried to escape, didn't work. So, yeah, she did what she did best. Well, actually, with a bit of luck, because if Nikki hadn't fallen on her knee when thrown out of the ring, the sharpshooter outside wouldn't have been, you know, much of a bother. But yeah, now, you know, it targets the knee, so yeah. But it's great, you know. I'm so much involved in that than with all those months with Carmella. But it's bad for Carmella because yeah, I guess that it was something to get her over a bit. But I mean, it failed, obviously. So yeah, a bit of a you know, backstage thing, people wanting answers from Dolph Ziggler, but he didn't give any. So yeah, he lost his match against Kalisto with a fucking rolling crucifix. Not that he looked any good during the match with Kalisto, but yeah, I guess that's what he meant by reaching a bottom. Not only losing to Kalisto, but also losing to a fucking rolling crucifix pin. Not even the Salida del Sol, a fucking rolling crucifix pin. So Ziggler just lost it while Kalisto was celebrating. Bam, zigzag, bam, chair shot. Hey, Apollo Crews, you're arriving late to the party, but don't, you know, don't fear. I still have some chair shots for you. Bam, and one last chair shot to Kalisto for good measure. Yeah. So yeah, some more backstage stuff. American Alpha, you know, they know that they can beat the Wyatt. John Cena saying, I'm John Cena, I recognize. Who the hell does Baron Corbin think he is? I point at the toughest guy in the room and I'm gonna punch his teeth down his throat, which would have been a cool line if not uttered, you know, basically word for word by Baron Corbin when he challenged John Cena next week. I mean, I guess that they wanted to mirror it, but it just doesn't come off as the same. So the, you know, the Wyatt said that they are taking back the titles, and I, you know, you just don't believe that. Why? Because, you know, they are from the Bayou, and where are we? Near the Bayou, Cajun Country, Baton Rouge. So yeah, American Alpha versus the Wyatts for the represented by Bray Wyatt and Randy Orton, for the SmackDown Tag Team titles. And the match was pretty forgettable. Like, it was a testament to the resiliency of Chad Gable. You know, he got through a lot. And yet, it looked like a pretty cheap victory, because it only happened when Randy Orton got thrown in Luke Harper, who was on the ring apron. And yeah, then it was pretty much a cheap pin, like not even the grand amplitude. Then again, Jason Jordan was essentially out. So yeah, the bigger story is that the Wyatts are going to kill each other. Like, at first it was just only Orton and Harper, but then Bray was, you know, wanting to separate them, and he got kicked by Harper. But I mean, it was a kick directed at Orton. Yeah. So yeah. And I guess that American Alpha can enter themselves into the Royal Rumble match, which, you know, makes sense, you know, gives meaning to what Ambrose said when he entered himself in the Royal Rumble. He was like, I am the first SmackDown champion to enter the Royal Rumble match, which means that, yeah, maybe American Alpha can enter themselves, because I don't see Becky Lynch or Alexa Bliss entering the Royal Rumble. And I mean, AJ Styles, he's got a match, but maybe, you know, maybe he wants to just hog the spotlight. Speaking of Lynch and Alexa Bliss, why am I saying that, you know, it could be one or the other? Well, back to backstage, actually in Daniel Bryan's office, there was a little bit of a backstage thing with Becky Lynch showing the images of last week's match, when she clearly made Alexa Bliss tap out, and then was like, Daniel Bryan was like, who's the other luchadora? And Becky Lynch was like, well, if you know, the one thing's for sure, it couldn't be Eva Marie, because she's too vain to wear a mask. And pretty much on these words, Alexa Bliss arrived, said that she was investigating the identity of La Luchadora, and that, you know, Lynch was goading Bryan into giving her yet another title shot. Except that, you know, Bryan had his mindset. So what's gonna happen, you know, to prevent any outside interventions? Next week, it's a women's title match in a cage. Oh boy! Just Alexa Bliss was furious. So she stormed out of the office, and then he continued on Talking Smack, where they were the first guests actually. And Alexa Bliss was mad because, Becky Lynch pretty much dislocated her elbow last week and she didn't apologize. Actually, Bliss didn't get any get-well tweets, any get-well gifts? I don't know, the only thing she got was a text, and it wasn't actually for her, because it was a wrong number. Fuck. So, yeah, she also said that she was champion at the end of 2016, and she plans on being the champion at the end of 2017. And then Lynch said, yeah, well, hold on to your title real close for the next 7 days, because I'm going to take you, like, she made pretty much a list of where, you know, Bliss should take the title with her, so at the shower, and even at the toilet. So maybe it'll clean up the title from all of that crap that she talks. Oh boy. So yeah, it's getting pretty heated, and I like it. So yeah, back to SmackDown with Carmella and James Ellsworth against CJ Lunda. I don't know how to pronounce that name. They didn't say it even one time. JBL was too, you know, it was too busy making old time references. Ha ha ha. Oh boy, she looks old and she cannot move in the ring. Oh boy, that's funny. I'm JBL. You know, I'm just untouchable. No, you're not actually. Yeah, Carmella won with the cut of silence after a kind of botched maneuver, but it wasn't actually all on her. Like, the jobber didn't know what to do. James Ellsworth got himself, in the match twice. And next week they are going for a shopping spree, so I cannot wait to look to see how Ellsworth looks. Oh God. Maybe the match was a bit too long actually. John Cena versus Baron Corbin. So Baron Corbin was backstage, you know, he was really focused. AJ Styles went to talk to him. Yeah, it's a big night, haha, and all that. They started his Styles' music way too early. You know, like at one point he just walked off, saying, "Yeah, it's all be on commentary," and then he walked back, you know, in the shot, and he said some more stuff, but the music was already on, so yeah, kind of ruined his entrance. The match, you know, could have been good if not for both Cena and Styles selling Corbin short, because I mean it was fairly obvious that Baron Corbin wasn't gonna win. We didn't need, you know, just a memo that he wasn't going to fucking win. You don't need that. You know, John Cena is, you know, the story of John Cena versus AJ Styles is probably bigger than the story of Baron Corbin's future push, because it will happen. He will get a title push, maybe even a world title push, though I would prefer him to get first and then, you know, the AC title. That'll elevate him, I guess. I don't know, just... and I don't... You know, it's the worst thing is... Baron Corbin basically dominated through the whole match, and I cannot really pinpoint a time where the momentum shifted, because it literally was throw Cena in a corner, Cena counters with the you know, kind of a drop kick, and then tornado DDT, because I mean he kind of, you know, powerbombed himself, he landed on his tailbone, and then what happened? Five moves of fucking doom, and Cena won like that. And yeah, there was a, you know, stare down between Cena and AJ Styles, and how the show closed. Anyway, talking smack. So Shane was on the show, and usually, you know, he said, "Yeah, you don't keep me for too long." But this time, he was in for the whole show. That I didn't understand, because, you know, Daniel Bryan was there, so I don't know why, you know, they had Shane on the show too. I don't know. The first guests were Becky Lynch and Alexa Bliss. The second guest was Mojo Rawley. We had, you know, the story of how Mojo Rawley is still, you know, very close to Zack Ryder. Actually, Zack Ryder is going to the gym every day despite not being cleared for another month. And then we got the origin story of Mojo Rawley. So, Mojo Rawley was, you know, the youngest guy to get an MBA in the University of Maryland or something like that. He went to the Arizona Cardinals in the NFL, got injured, and that's how he ended up in the WWE. But what happened during that time? So, while on injury, he was put back into free agency, and he got some offers from the NFL, from other teams in the NFL, from Wall Street even, because, you know, NBA, all that, apparently he deserved that, and he also got a call for a tryout in the WWE. Why? Because Gronk's father, actually, Gronk is Mojo Rawley's best friend, so Gronk's father was college dorm rooms, college dorm roommates with IRS, Mike Rotunda. So yeah, that's how he got a tryout for the WWE, and at first he didn't believe that, he believed that it was a prank call, and then, you know, WWE, Mojo Rawley. So apparently Mojo is going to drop that hike frat boy attitude, because it was just a ploy to get, you know, to get Zack Ryder heated, and so that he could, you know, kick ass while there was step out of the curtain, which kind of, you know, is for people only watching on the main roster, it makes sense, but from NXT it doesn't really make sense, because he was hyped before that. So I don't know, maybe more serious Mojo Rawley would still be hyped, I don't know, we'll see. And the last guest was Dolph Ziggler, who had a lot to say actually, but didn't say a lot, ironically. So yeah, he said that he was frustrated about not getting chances these past few years, and that on SmackDown it could be even worse, you know, because you don't just get the chances, you really have to earn them. He wanted to stand out, to be better for the show and for himself, because he did, and I actually didn't sleep at night, because he wasn't feeling that good. He said that, you know, attacking Kalisto and Apollo Crews felt like a rebirth, like he was in the same state of mind as when he won the world title with the Money in the Bank, you know, the cash in that everyone lost their minds. Yeah, that if they want retribution, he's always there, he won't miss a show, you know, house show, whatever. He's entering himself in the Rumble. Shane accepts, so that, you know, lifts something from the minds of everyone else. Like, if I say that I'm in the Rumble, does that mean that I mean? No, you have to, you actually have to go through the commissioner. Yeah, and just one thing that bothered me during Talking Smack was that Shane's microphone just picked up too much background noise, and also, you know, his heavy breathing. Yeah. So, moving down to 205 Live, which was actually tons of fun. Lots of stuff happened. Some of it was pretty, you know, you could feel that it was going to happen. Some of it you were like, oh, that's actually pretty surprising. So let's start with Cedric Alexander versus Noam Dar. Corey Graves described Noam Dar's clingy attitude as a real romantic story. Like, what the fuck are you smoking, man? Yeah. And Mauro Ranallo is the only one to not have adhered to the theory that basically everything can be, you know, resolved with a thumb to the eye. So Alicia Fox at one point stepped between Dar and Alexander, because Dar was at the outside. He was actually hitting pretty hard on Alexander, and then Alexander, you know, managed to recover and threw a pretty vicious missile dropkick into Dar that, well, launched him into the side of the table. And then he said he was like admonishing Alicia Fox for stepping between the both of them, and you're like, why the fuck are you doing that? She helped you. What the fuck is going through your mind? And then, you know, Alicia Fox just pulled Dar out of a moonsault. You know, she seemed confused, and we are confused that she seemed confused. Like, they don't even, you know, they don't have the same trunks. Their skin is not the same color. They don't have the same haircut. Nothing about them is similar. Not even their knee pads, their boots. Maybe their boots. I don't know. I don't remember. But yeah, how can you confuse the both of them? And basically, it's opened the door to Noam Dar's victory with a running enziguri. Like, at one point, I kind of was, you know, I thought that might be a Shining Wizard. Mauro Ranallo, we call it a Busekuni. She's completely out of, you know, okay, sure thing, man. Yeah, so it was a running enziguri. There was a little vignette for Akira Tozawa's debut with Kalisto hyping it up. Don't understand why Kalisto, you know, doesn't appear on 205 Live every now and again. Maybe it's because Sin Cara is not in the Cruiserweight division anymore. Yeah, just doesn't quite make sense. Apparently they're just gonna call him Tozawa, which is not good. Like, what are you doing? Deron Kendrick was in the ring addressing what happened last week with Tajiri, the Mist. He said, you're a sneaky snake and a sneaky snake. And he'll make sure that next time he's gonna choke on the Mist. Then also addressed some words to his opponent of the night, Sean Maluta, you know, saying that, yeah, he might come from a great family, you know, a great lineage and all that, but he's not gonna last 30 seconds with Deron Kendrick. And except he did, actually, for basically all of the match. Sean Maluta dominated Deron Kendrick. It wasn't even close. Well, you can see why they don't put much trust into Sean Maluta, because his Rolling Thunder was fucking slow. And yeah, I mean, at one point he just fucked up a you know, a high flying maneuver, and yeah, got reversed into the bully choke. So the Deron Kendrick won. More stuff backstage. The breakup between Cedric Alexander and Alicia Fox. Oh boy, that was coming. You know, it was happening, but I didn't think that it would be so violent. Like, he said that Alicia Fox and the pervert Noam Dar were made for each other. Oh god! Yeah, and it unleashed the inner Dio that lived in Alicia Fox. Like, she went like, ah, why are you no one breaks up with me! Cedric, come back! And she really did the pose when Dio does Ray! You know, Ray! So, yeah, it was pretty intense. There was the parlay. I didn't know what the fuck it was about. Actually, it was just a contract signing between Jack Gallagher, who thinks that Daivari besmirched his honor, and Daivari, who's like, yeah, but people who fight with honor, they are getting stomped by people who are like me, who fight, you know, to win. So yeah, it was a contract signing for an I forfeit match, which is essentially an I quit match, but with more honor. Yeah, so that's going to be fun. It's going to happen on 205 Live next week? Soon? I don't know. But it's going to be fun. It's actually something new. Like, could be reaching new levels of violence, and it will actually be the end of that rivalry, as Jack Gallagher said. You know, they live with the loss. And the main event between Rich Swann and Tony Nese. So, you know, it's actually good for Tony Nese, because it looked like he could hang with the top of the Cruiserweight division. Like, he's the premier athlete, But until now, I mean, he thought Cedric Alexander, and you know that's nothing against Cedric Alexander, you know that's nothing against Jagger, who's fucking entertaining. It's just that, so far, the top of the card in the Cruiserweight division, it's, you know, TJ Perkins, the Brian Kendrick, Rich Swann, and Neville. So, yeah, he, you know, looking good against the former champion, well, the champion, actually, no former champion, the current champion, is great, but, you know, as much as you don't take someone whose nickname, the Premier Athlete, lightly, Rich Swann won with the Swan Song. Then, you know, he started, you know, bad-mouthing, Neville, and Neville came out, haha, you're funny, you know, you're attacking my physique, oh boy, but actually, you know, it's actually, was going to be, once again, your downfall with your arrogance and your ignorance and all that. So, yeah, Rich Swann was like, ha ha ha, oh, I didn't catch that, because, you know, unlike you, not everyone has Dumbo ears, boo, oh boy, second week in a row where, you know, you insult you are a top babyface, and you insult the division's top heel, and you get booed by the audience. Oh boy, that's not where you want to be. And yeah, so after Royal Rumble, Neville got his match for the Cruiserweight title against the Royal Rumble pay-per-view against Rich Swann. So it's going to be mighty entertaining. I'm looking forward to that. Yeah, I mean, the crowd was sound every week. You know, every week, each passing week, more into that, into the show. So that's great. Anyway, thanks for watching. See you tomorrow. Holy shit, that's a long time. 27 minutes. Jesus. Bye bye. I don't know why I'm recording tomorrow's video blog, honestly. Because of how long the upload is going to be. Oh boy. Bye.